This episode gives an overview of metal powder bed fusion. Even so, there's a lot of similarities between polymer powder bed fusion and metal powder bed fusion. I still want to highlight how the metal process works and talk about some of the distinguishing features that they have. Here you see examples. You also see the freedom of design that we have here. But as we look at the schematic, let's just move over. As we look at the schematic, we see that there's almost everything looks similar, but there's very, very distinct difference, and that is that we need support structure here. And the support structure in that case is not needed because the metal powder couldn't support the molten metal locations. It's rather that we need the support structures for thermal management to get the energy out of the part conducted away. Otherwise, we would get a lot of shrinkage and warpage in the parts that would make them unusable. Here you see a difference. It's used a blade or recoder arm, but again, that's also some polymer processes have that. And in addition to the laser beam, some machines work with an electron beam, and that looks a little bit different up here. But that's very detailed differences that I don't go into detail here. So the advantages of metal powder bed fusion is that you can manufacture parts in standard metals with high density, so higher than 99.9%. The material selection is constantly widening much faster than for the polymers that are available. Stainless steel, tool steel, titanium, copper, nickel, all kinds of alloys. The material portfolio is really widening every couple of weeks. You get isotropic material properties, which is super important, and the parts can be further processed. So you can do hybrid processes, or in the process you're already doing some subtractive operations, or you can do them afterwards. Disadvantages are definitely that the parts need support structures. So when we look at these here, you see that we can get delicate features, or here we can get intricate inside channels. We can blow that powder out, but we still need support structures in a big way that require to be removed afterwards, and they reuse more material that we need to recycle. So the removal is important, and that we can stack parts, so we can't get as much parts in a powder bed than we can with the polymer parts. The technology is still expensive, so machines are quite heavy price tags. The tolerances and surface finishes are limited, again, because of that powdery surface structure, and we get different crystalline structures due to the rapid cooling. That means different than in casting and other processes. Again, we need to understand that to move the technology forward, and a lot has happened in that. It's just something to be aware of, and maybe something that is even tailored. And again, a lot of effort has been put into that, and advancements have been made. Applications, I put a couple here. This is a sample part from EOS, similar to what I have here, where we have this cooling channels inside. It's used for prototypes, for support parts, but also small series parts, also like this bracket from Airbus. This is not a serial part because everyone can be different, but it definitely shows that for artificial hips, there's more and more of these titanium solutions available. So it's an individualized small series, and tools for injection molding with conformal cooling, which really also moves that technology forward quite a bit.